coming a magnificent move of the Holy Spirit. And God is going to use you to bring healing to people's lives. Not just their bodies, but their whole being. Will thou be made whole was the question in John 5. Jesus said to the man, will thou be made whole? His favorite question. And I think if you will only focus on God using you to bring wholeness to people's lives all around you, God will so bless you, he will extend your life as a result. Now, sickness is the result of the fall of man. The Bible tells us very clearly that the fall of man brought about death. The good news is that the Bible says in Galatians 3:13 that we have been delivered from the curse of death, from the curse of the law. When Jesus, our precious Lord, hung on that cross, he broke the curse. Now, let's understand something I also said last week, that the law that God gave through Moses was a law that came to give life. But because the people of Israel were living in sin, rather than the law bringing life, it brought death. So the Bible says, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, and so on. That law was to produce life in the hearer, those who heard it. But when the law was given, they realized, I've been killing, and I've been stealing, and I've been doing all the wrong things. Therefore, the law that was meant to give me life now has condemned me to death. And the Word of God goes on to say, if one part of the law is broken, the whole law is broken. And God placed a curse in Deuteronomy 28:15 and on, which we dealt with last week. It's called the curse of the law. In that curse was the promise of disease and sickness. God said, if you'll break the law, you will get sick. So sickness came as a result of disobedience. Now please understand, all sickness and death goes back to the fall of man. It's the fall of man that brought about death and sickness in the world. Every baby that is born in innocence is born to die. Every baby is born into the curse, into that condemnation of the law. But through Jesus, we are delivered from the curse of the law. And the minute we are in Christ, not outside Christ, when we are in Christ, his liberty becomes our liberty. For only he fulfilled the law. Only he lived the kind of life that fulfilled the commandments of God. And so in him, we fulfill the law in Christ Jesus. Outside Christ, I cannot be righteous. Only in Christ, I am righteous. Now, something else. The Christian life begins with Christ in me. That's not enough. I must also be in Christ. In Christ means I am in fellowship with him. In Christ means I am one with him. There are many Christians today who are saved but not living the life. Therefore, they are not in Christ. In Christ demands a daily walk, daily fellowship. It requires union with Him. I can have Christ in me and be carnal. But the minute I'm in Christ, I cannot live a carnal life. I'm now living in His righteousness. So those who are in Christ are free, not those who have Christ in them. That's not enough. Because if I have Christ in me, I'm saved, yes, but I'm still a child. And Galatians chapter 4 tells me, you got to see this, this is very powerful. Galatians 4 verse 1 tells me, even though I may be the heir, even though all the promises are mine, as long as I'm a child, I am no different than a slave. Now I say that the heir, as long as he's a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all. In other words, if a Christian doesn't know his rights, if a believer is not living the life in Christ, he's no different than a slave. He's a child. God demands that children become sons. And the Bible tells me in Romans 8 that only those who are led of the Spirit are sons. There's a big difference between a child and a son. A child is born again, but a son is walking in the Spirit. Children cannot walk in the Spirit. Children are walking in carnality and the flesh. If you understand what I just said, say yes. So there are many believers who say, well, I'm saved on my way to heaven, but they are carnal. And since they are carnal, they cannot qualify for the promises of God. Because the promises of God are given in Christ Jesus, it says. All the promises in Him are yea and amen, not outside of Him. So I can be saved and still be outside that place of blessing and protection that's only found in Christ Jesus. In Christ means I am walking with Him in fellowship, daily communion, praise, worship. He's talking to me. I'm talking to Him. I'm a sheep who follows Him, not one who doesn't know what I'm doing. If you cannot hear His voice, it's because you're not walking in Him. Walking in Christ, I hear His voice. Walking in Christ, I receive the benefits of salvation. Walking in Christ, I'm healed. Walking in Christ, I'm strong. Walking in Christ, there's joy. Walking in Christ, there's everything I need to live the Christian life. But the second I quit fellowshipping with the Lord, I'm down in the pits again. So, to have Christ in me, I am still in the flesh. But to be in Christ, the flesh is crucified. The minute I am in Christ, the flesh has no place. I'm free from the flesh when I'm in Christ. Because now I am part of Him. I am flesh of His flesh, bone of His bone, walking in the Spirit, enjoying the benefits of salvation completely. And not many Christians are walking there. That is our destination. It's time we live as Christians ought to live. Daily fellowship. And we break the flesh. We destroy the flesh as we pray and intercede. Seek me with all your heart. I shall be found of you. And then the next verse in Jeremiah 29 says, I'll bring you out of captivity. That's in Jeremiah 29. The Bible tells me, yes, I'm teaching on healing, but when I teach on healing, I touch on everything. In Jeremiah chapter 29, 29, It says this. This is something powerful. Everybody needs to hear it. Verse 13, you shall seek me and find me when you'll search for me with all your heart, and I shall be found of you. Verse 14 says, and I will turn away your captivity, and I'll gather you from all nations. The minute you find God, you're free from bondage. So it is prayer and only prayer that delivers me from that flesh that sticks on me so easily. Now, the flesh has many layers. You got to hear this. The flesh has many layers. It's not easy to be free from the flesh because the flesh has more than one layer on top of you. You know, it's like when I was baptizing people in the River Jordan, they put that, what do you call that thing? They zipped me with their wetsuit. And you zip that wetsuit on you, and you, it sticks on your flesh. Think about 10 wetsuits on top of you. The flesh has many layers. You got to break out. And breaking out can be very, 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 very tough. Because as you're walking in this life of carnality, if you're not walking in God, you're still saved. I'm not saying you're not saved. Oh, yes, Jesus is in you. You're on your way to heaven, but very, very difficult, with much difficulty are you walking. Because people that are in the flesh cannot run. Because people in the flesh are heavy laden with a whole lot of stuff on their life, because the flesh has many layers of bondage and sin, just like those wetsuits on top of you. And so you're walking like a robot. You can't move that quick. Be free from that. And the only way to be free is through prayer. Well, all your heart. If you sing with all your heart, half-hearted requests, half-hearted cries, half-hearted prayers don't work. You gotta seek God with intensity. The fervent prayer of a righteous man avails and breaks through. It's calling on God from the inside of you. Now, when you begin to do that, you break out of the flesh, and the layers begin to fly right off of you. And as they do, you become more and more liberated, freer and freer and freer, till now you're running. They that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They shall walk and then run. Or I should say, they'll run and they'll walk. And the reason, by the way, in Isaiah 40, running comes before walking, is because you're catching up with God. You're running to catch up, and then you're walking with Him. Now you're hearing His voice again. And next thing you know, the curse is broken. The curse comes off. Because the curse has bound itself. It is a part of the flesh. Where the flesh is, the curse works. Where the flesh is, the curse is strong. Where the flesh is, there's sickness, disease, bondage, misery, you name it. But the second you're free from that flesh, you start getting into that healing realm. God cannot use you to bring healing to others if you're carnal. It's impossible to release healing out of your life if you don't have what it takes. You cannot give away what you don't have. So when you walk in the Spirit, there's a flow, there's a blessed river flowing through your life. And you're able to minister to people. Now, the minute you are liberated, that's why in the crusades I used to have, that I now am restarting in America, I'm still doing them around the world, I found a key. You listen to me real good, huh? You can pray every day, but the flesh will try to stick on you. Maybe a layer of it can grab you. It is daily prayer that keeps you free. Because walking in this world is like walking through a hallway, a corridor, with a whole lot of things that want to stick on you. I saw a movie years ago, and I saw a man walking through a long corridor with a lot of spider webs. And all those webs were so thick and so heavy, they were sticking on him as he's walking through. That's what happens to you every day you walk in this world. Something is latching onto you every day. Maybe it gets on your arm, your neck, your head, your eyes, or part of your body. But something is trying to grab you as you're walking through this life of faith. It is prayer and only prayer that takes it off. Prayer has the ability to wipe off all that stuff that latches onto you as you walk in this life. Understand? Yeah. Now, if you neglect prayer, let's say you've been praying 2 weeks ago, you prayed real good, real strong, and you've been feeling God's presence every day, and you're really free, and you're joyful, and you're singing in the shower. And you notice that you're singing in the Spirit now, and you're singing new songs unto the Lord, and melody has become a part of your fellowship. That's because you're in the Spirit. Anybody listening? But now you neglect prayer, and the next thing you see is the song stops. The first thing that happens when prayer is absent is the song of the Lord dies. There's no song in it. There's no melody. There's no joy. And now you're walking through this corridor, which we all walk through every single day of our life. And the stuff starts to stick onto you from the world. It's jumping out of everywhere. It's coming through the radio, the magazines, the TV, the internet, the kids, the friends, the phone calls, all the junk of life comes on you. But you're not, you get busy, and you get busier, and you get busier. And now you neglect day two, day three, day four, day five. Next thing you know, you're slowing down. There's less prayer, less breath, less spirit, less Christianity, more carnality, and what's coming out of your mouth is what you should not be saying. Your language changes. Are you getting it? Over here you are praising, over there you are cussing. And you're noticing yourself. You're not the real you. You're the carnal you. And as you're walking through this web hallway, whatever you want to call it, it's just sticking onto you. You know what happens quickly? You don't want to pray for nobody. Because the minute the flesh gets on you, it kills the desire to be a giving person. It kills in you the joy of ministering to anyone else. Now it's a burden to preach. It's a burden to do anything for God. Because now it's no longer a joyful experience. It's a boring experience. It's a difficult thing to do. Well, one day God talks to you lovingly, sweetly, and you wake up in the morning, and for some reason a song hits you for no reason, because God, the Holy Spirit, will talk to you. It is no secret what God can do, what is done for. He'll do for you. So you say, I know what to do. I got to get back to what I know I got to get back to and get all this mess off of me. And you start praying, and you find it is harder now to pray than it was 2 weeks ago. Why? Because you're rusty. You're heavy laden. The flesh and its layers have come upon you, and now you are bound with more than 10 layers of flesh on you, and you got to break out. Then you break out and find yourself. Find your liberty. And the first thing that happens, if you're called to heal the sick, you are ready to lay hands on anything that moves. You can't wait to be in the service again. You want to lay hands on anybody around you. You start ministering to people that don't even need your prayer. Anybody understands? Put your hand up. Oh, yeah. Because when you're in the Spirit of your Heavenly Father is now in operation. And the Spirit of your Heavenly Father is a giving Spirit. He wants to give and bless and pour out of Himself. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. And now you are so free again because those layers of the flesh have blown off of you. And if you can't find someone to pray for and lay hands on, you start crying out to God for them. You start praying for your enemies that you cussed at last week. Boy, I'm really getting through to you real good tonight. Because now the Spirit of God is in control, not the flesh. And suddenly you forgive. You hated that guy 3 days ago. Now you forgive him. Why? The Holy Ghost is in operation now. He's pouring out of you. And that's the only way to prepare for ministry. So in the Crusades, I would begin to pray at 2 in the afternoon. And I'll tell you honestly, sometimes I would get to those cities. And back in the days when I lived in Florida, we would fly the same day. And we flew commercial. And I had people cuss at me on the plane sometimes. And I would get to the hotel all disturbed. I had a fight with my brother Chris in San Antonio, Texas one time. And I thought, dear God, how can I minister tonight to 20,000 people when my brother and I were screaming at each other in the van? I told him off. I rebuked him for his rebellion. And I get to the hotel. It's 1 in the afternoon. We flew in. I was tired, exhausted, sweaty, and mad in the world. I wanted to kill my brother Chris for messing my head. And I get to prayer. Boy, it was tough getting in there. Because you start to pray and you're nowhere. Your head isn't thinking straight. So I put my beautiful, I used to have a CD player. Now it's the iPods and iPads, whatever, iPhones. Had a nice CD player, and I stuck that beautiful CD, The Majesty and the Glory. The two CDs, one called The Majesty and the Glory, the other's called Majesty and the Glory of the Resurrection. And as I'm playing that CD, and a beautiful hymn comes on, I start crying. And now the presence of Jesus begins to take over. And I start crying out to God. It was 3 in the afternoon by now. It took me a whole hour and a half at least to just break through. Because I had so much on my head. And I start praying, and by now it's 3 o'clock. And 3 o'clock, heaven came down and glory filled my soul. And I'm beginning to pray. And now I'm praying in tongues, and I'm praying like a train, like a bullet train running down the rails. Because when you're in the Spirit, you're really praying in tongues. It's not Shandai and you and all the things that don't mean a thing to you. And it's the real deal now coming out of you. The real language of the Holy Spirit coming out of you. And you can tell the difference. Tears pouring down. Kent Maddox in those days used to stay next door. And I got so blessed. It was 4 o'clock now. I couldn't wait for the crusade. I had to go lay hands on somebody. Because when you're flowing, you're flowing. You're ready to go. And the Lord said, no. My friend Paulino, Jean Paulino, had a problem with his leg, his nerve. What do you call that? No, sciatica. He was in such pain, he couldn't move that day. And I said, oh, Jesus, heal him. He was touched instantly. I walk into the green room. I am so anointed, I'm buzzing. I walk into the green room. There's Cheryl there. Wham! She's on the floor. Jeffrey, bang, is on the floor. Anybody who came near me was on the floor. I was laying hands on anything that had moved that night. I was laying hands before the service ever began. And I came on that platform. I was almost flying up there. And man, I looked so good. I felt so marvelous. John Hagee sits next to me. He says, my God, you look good. I said, I feel marvelous. I'm ready to go. Boy, I came out off my seat like I was Superman. But it took 4 hours of prayer. What if I didn't? What if I said, forget it? I would have flopped. It doesn't take long to touch God. You know that picture you see of Michelangelo, God reaching down to man? And you see Adam's finger and God's finger touching. Brother, I like that. I think God's hand is always reaching out to us. He's just waiting for us to reach up and touch him. As many as touched him were made whole. And now the healing anointing starts to flow. Whew. I'm giving you secrets of the anointing here. You see, ladies and gentlemen, that anointing is inside all of us. But the layers of flesh keep it in from flowing out. You got to get those layers, pow, right off of you. So you can flow in the Spirit. Anybody getting this?
Yes.
You bet. Now, the minute, let me just say this quick. It is the tongue that brings disease. It is the tongue that brings healing. Because sickness is the result of the misuse of the tongue. In Exodus 15, they murmured. They misused their own tongue. Sickness came. You see, throughout the Old Covenant, people complaining. They complained, so the serpents came. They complained, other stuff came. Every time they spoke something negative, sickness came. Because sickness is the result of the tongue being used in a wrong manner. The misuse of the tongue. But when the tongue is used properly in prayer now, brings healing. Remember it says, pray one for another that you may be healed. It's the tongue being used properly now. So, how could I minister healing any place? Like I'll take that San Antonio experience. How could I have ministered healing after my brother and I were getting into a fight in the car? I had to change the use of my tongue. But it's impossible to change the use of your tongue until you've prayed. Because when you prayed and the flesh began to fly off of you, now the real Holy Ghost language came in. And your tongue was speaking heavenly now. It was a heavenly language now. And next thing you know, I'm praying so fast like a bullet train in tongues. And I'm walking around my room and I'm just in flowing blessed Holy Spirit power. When I get to the service and I'm ready to take off like the space shuttle. Because you see, it's the tongue. The remedy to healing is the blood of Jesus. It's the atonement. Now, and I dealt with this last week. But I believe it is important that when you minister healing, that you yourself be free from the flesh and its layers, but also from speaking truth. Because the scripture says in John, 8:32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So now you come to the sick or to a crowd, and you begin to declare truth, truth, truth. That's what I did for years in my crusades, and I still do that. The minute I come on, I start giving them the truth of God's word when it comes to healing. Healing is in the Bible. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word. I have got to declare the truth of God's word on healing. Because as I do, there's liberty coming into the hearts of men. It's impossible to bring healing to the sick until the truth has penetrated their hearts. And ye shall know the truth. They must know the truth. Without knowing the truth, they cannot be healed. Now God in his amazing mercy will heal an atheist. God in his amazing mercy will heal a sinner. But listen carefully, that healing to the sinner or the atheist or those in carnality comes as a result of God's mercy, and in most cases they lose that healing. But the healing that comes to the believer in covenant will stay for life. Because God brings healing to the believer because of his covenant. And in that covenant, in the atonement of that covenant, there's healing that will last for life. Every person I have ever dealt with who lost their healing was not walking in covenant. They were not solid believers. A Presbyterian lady came to my service in Toronto, Canada, who was dying with cancer. She had lost her hair because of chemotherapy. The power of God came on her. She was completely healed. The pain left. The hair grew. 6 months later, she went back to church, and her pastor told her it's all a lie in her brain, in her mind. And she believed him. That woman was dead 60 days later. Shook the whole family, because she went back to a preacher who was not walking in the spirit, and he killed what God gave her because she had no foundation, no strength. While Joan Giessen's daughter, who also was healed miraculously, when they told her it's all a lie in her mind, she said, no, because the Bible says. Brother, she had the truth. It was that kept her healing. But that poor woman from that Presbyterian church who had no foundation, no covenant relationship with God, lost it and died. So God healed her because of mercy. Jesus, his heart is moved with compassion on all people. Not just his people, all people. Jesus never healed the sick and asked anyone, one of them, are you a real law-abiding Jewish man? Have you obeyed every rule in the Bible before I heal you? No. He healed them all. He healed the man who betrayed him, who went and told him, it's Jesus who told me to carry my bed on Saturday. John 5, the dear man at the pool of Bethesda. Betrayed his Lord, betrayed the Son of God, and he was healed. No covenant. I had a man named Mr. Rantisi came to my meetings back in Canada. I would have Monday night meetings, crowds packed everywhere, and he walked in, and I had a lady named Danielle. And I trained her on how to find healings. I had some powerful people, all ladies, boy, they're the best people, all ladies. Powerful people, powerful ladies. So Philip comes in, this guy, Philip Rantisi was his name, he comes in and he's walking like a robot. I'm not kidding you. He had a brace from his neck down. He walked in, he was wrapped in metal. I mean wrapped. He's walking. And as he's walking, he's making noises. All the steel was making noise. She walks up to him right in the lobby. In the name of Jesus, be healed. Wham! The man is on the floor. They pick him up and he starts to rip himself off. The metal starts flying. Well, she comes running down. didn't call me pastor then because I wasn't a pastor. Benny. She's running, screaming. Whoa. She said this man, and she tells me about this man's healing. When I came on the platform, I would always begin with, he touched me. Well, now God was touching somebody else, not me. And I was just going crazy. I came on and the people were screaming, Canadians. I mean, these are cold, frozen, chosen people that didn't do a thing but just stare at you. And I'm just stunned because they're all praising the Lord and crying and, oh, hallelujah, praise Jesus. I had a choir half from Trinidad and half from Jamaica and half from the islands. They were all from the islands. Those people couldn't be quiet for even 5 minutes. They were, hallelujah, praise God, amen. Oh, man, they were going behind me like they were having a revival. And that man was standing there with his whatever thing in his hand. God healed them completely. We had miracles that night. They were flying out of their seats, I'm telling you. But there was no covenant in that man. CBC, I mean CBC Canada, wanted to do a report on him. Dear Philip, they go to his house and they talk to him. And he says, no, I was not healed. No, that's not true. Well, I had given CBC a full report. And in those days, we didn't have cameras in our meetings because it was not on television yet. So he lied. So the girl from CBC called me. She said, look, this guy. I said, no, it can't be. That man was healed. I'm telling you. I'm going on like this. She said, well, he told us nothing happened. So I called him. I said, Philip, what are you doing? He was an Arab. Yeah, an Arabic guy. I spoke to him in English and Arabic, so make sure they understood. So what are you doing? God healed you. Oh, yes, he did. I said, you told that girl who called this morning. Oh, he said, Brother Benny, if I should tell them I was healed, I would lose my compensation. I said, what? He said, they've been paying me money. He said, for me to tell the world that I'm healed, I'd have to go back to work. I would lose my compensation. I would lose what they're giving me. I said, you are lying. You're lying. And not only are you lying, you're lazy. And not only are you lazy, you have broken the law of God. And you're greedy too. I said those words to him. I said, you want to keep your check coming from that insurance company? I said, Philip, be careful. The sickness that you are free from will come back. Oh, no. God will. I said, don't you start telling me what God will do. I said, the God I know will not play games. I said, I warn you, if you will not be truthful and live righteously, the same sickness and worse will come back. He laughed at me, almost cussed me out. That man was back in his brace a week later. He died, I think, still a cripple. You don't play games with God, brother. God healed him because of his mercy, but he couldn't keep it because he was not walking in covenant. I want to understand, say yes. Yes. Here in Los Angeles years ago, a woman came to Amy Semple McPherson's meeting down in Los Angeles here. She was totally deaf. God healed her completely. And about 3-4 weeks later, the deafness came back. And she came back to Amy and said, it's back. I'm deaf again. She said, what did you do after you were healed? She said, oh, I went back into the bars. She used to enjoy to go into the bars, drink and smoke and have fun with sinners. And Amy said, did you think God opened your ears so you can hear garbage again? Did you think God would open your ears so you can go back into sin again? No, my brother, it's about the covenant. People lose their healing because they're not walking in covenant. My goodness, I have your attention tonight. The truth, it's all about the truth. You shall know the truth will set you free. Now, the minute The minute you pour the truth into them, something will happen in people's hearts. Suddenly, they will begin to get that revelation and truth that it's His will for them to be whole. The reason people pray, if it is your will, that destroys the seed of the truth because the truth has not been planted properly in them. It's not enough to tell truth. It's how you plant the truth. I want to deal with this now for the next few moments. I believe you plant the truth by creating an image of facts. When I minister the word in my crusades, even Oral Roberts told me this. He said, you don't have to have 100 messages. You just need 3 good ones. Because you pour the truth through those messages. You have to penetrate their hearts with it. The Bible tells me in Proverbs that the word of God must come from different sources and it must come with power. It has to penetrate. You see, you cannot see healing in people's lives till the word has broken through. And that's why Proverbs 4:20 says this, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my saying, let them not depart from your eyes, keep them in the midst of your heart. Now they are life unto those that find them and health to all their flesh. So when you're ministering the promises of healing, when you're delivering the word of God to do with healing, the first thing that's happening is people are hearing it, but that's not enough. What they hear must be received. It takes time. What they hear must be captured. Remember in the book of Acts, Paul is preaching the word of healing. He's looking at a man who's crippled. And at a moment, he noticed the man's faith begin to rise and rise and rise. And now the level was just right. And he said, stand up. But he didn't say stand up till the faith of the man was bubbling. What was going on? He was hearing it, but he had to receive it. So the key, 3 keys here. My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my saying. So now you hear it, you receive it, but it says something else. Let them not depart from thine eyes. You got to let them visualize it. When I minister healing, often I paint a picture. That's why you got to paint a picture before you can bring healing. You have to preach it till they receive it. And when they receive it, faith begins to bubble and you'll feel it. Seeing their faith, God's word says. Faith is something you can see on people's faces. I paint a picture. Here's Jesus sitting on a hill. It was just the right afternoon. The wind is just blowing. And I go through the holes in his hair is blowing and how lovely his eyes are. And there's a crowd climbing up that hill. And now what am I doing? They're seeing it. Let it not depart from thine eyes. You cannot bring healing till they see it. The word must be heard. The word must be received. And the word must be visualized. 3 keys to healing. You'll never bring healing to the sick without those 3. I just gave you a secret. You can't deliver people out of disease and sickness unless they heard the word, they received it, and receiving it is through repetition. Repetition will help them receive it. It's like breaking through, pounding, penetrating. Keep at it until faith rises. And faith will rise and you'll know it. You'll see it in their eyes. You'll see it on their face. And I told my people, I said, you can tell when they have faith on their face. And they said, how? And they said, how? I said, everything is speaking faith. Their eyes are speaking faith. Their actions are speaking faith. Their worship is speaking faith. Their praise, their tears, everything speaks faith. I went to pray for a man in Denver, Colorado, a pastor of a large church. He said to me, he said, Pastor Benny, I have prostate cancer. None of my people know. Please come have a service. But the real reason you're coming is to pray for me, but tell nobody you're coming for me, not them. I said, okay, Pastor, I'll come have a great healing service and pray for you at the right moment and say nothing. The anointing came on me. The power of God began to flow. I had preached the word. I was about to go lay hands on him, and I looked like, I said, dear God, he's like a cold fish. He was unmoved. I saw no faith. I saw no life. He was just staring, looking around. At the end of the service, he's worshiping Jesus. Tears flowing down his face. Ah, then the Lord said, now go lay hands on him. And as I went, the Lord said this to me. I'll never forget this. He said, now that I have become real to him, I will heal him. You have to make Jesus real. If you can't make Jesus real, don't bother praying for him. Jesus was real to me 2 hours earlier, but not real to him. So I could pray for the sick who are ready to receive because Jesus is real to them, but the pastor was the last one to believe. What is believing? Oh, that's a good one. Believing happens when faith, and when I say faith, I mean the person of faith. I mean the author of faith becomes real. When faith becomes real, and faith is a person, when Christ, who is our faith, becomes real to that person, healing will be as easy as breathing. But three things had to happen in that service. Heard it, received it, and then when he visualized it, when he saw the Son of God through his word, everything changed. And so the Bible says, for they are life now unto those that find them. And you cannot find the word of healing without those three keys. Finding takes time. It's like searching for jewels. It takes that attentive ear. It takes that receiving heart. It takes that steadfast look. That's that continual looking, continual. It's the where the imaginations come alive in that person. It's impossible to sow tares and reap wheat when your ears and eyes see symptoms. You'll reap the wrong crop. You have to change what their eyes are seeing. As long as, because sickness is a powerful thing the enemy uses. The minute sickness is in the body, that's all they see, that's all they hear, that's all they feel, that's all they know. I am sick. Their life becomes controlled by that sickness. They wake up at certain hours of the night to take medication because of that sickness. They have to change the way they live, the way they eat. Even everything changes with the family because now that sickness is in control. It is impossible to bring healing to that person if they're looking at the symptoms, because they're sowing. You cannot reap the right crop. You're reaping the wrong crop because you're looking at the wrong thing. Your ears and your eyes are seeing the symptoms. You've got to break that, and you break it with what I just gave you. It's imperative you understand what I just said. And the word now begins to work. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 12 and 13 says, the word works as faith arises. The word works in them that believe, it says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 12 and 13. So when, are you listening to me? Yeah. When I'm preaching healing, here's what I'm looking for. Look at me over. When I'm preaching healing, I'm aiming to do one thing. I'm aiming to take their eyes off themselves. I gotta get their eyes off themselves. Because as long as they see the sickness, the wheelchair, the symptom, they'll never get it. They'll never receive. I have got to take their attention away from them, from what they're looking at, because they've been living with that thing for a long time. That sickness has taken hold of them so strong, that's all they see, that's all they hear, that's all they feel. Everything about their life focuses on that one thing. Now they come for 3 hours, 4 hours, and in that short time, I have the responsibility to change the way they see themselves. It takes time. Every song, every piece of worship, everything that happens in the service must be used for one reason only: get them to see Jesus, not their sickness. The worship, that's why worship is powerful. Praise, you'll notice in our crusades, I do very little praise, a whole lot of worship. Why? Because they're focusing on Jesus, 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 it's Jesus, it's Jesus. Get them away from seeing themselves in their sickness. See Jesus. It's about the Master. And the songs I also use, I use song, oh, it is Jesus. I know exactly what I'm doing. It's all about the Master. Get them in front of their eyes. Make them real. Make Jesus real. Make him real to them. That's the key in every service I've had for 38 years of my life. The minute I've broken through, and you break through worship, you break through your message, you break through everything you say and do. Everything must be highly organized to the teeth. Every dot, every T. I mean, you've got to cross every T, dot every I, make sure you miss nothing. And God will bless you if you are organized. Even the songs must be right. Even the music, atmosphere. And it's all about atmosphere, because Jesus cannot walk into the wrong atmosphere. Prepare me a habitation wherein I may dwell, God said to Moses. You build an atmosphere, and the atmosphere is built with worship. And when you have that worship, people start to forget themselves. So the key is, you have to penetrate their heart with the word, plow the land, get that word in them till they hear it, get the word in them till they receive it, and when they receive it, faith starts to bubble out of their eyes and their actions. And next thing you know, as you begin to build that blessed image of healing, and now their whole vision changes, because now they're seeing the Master, not their own sickness. At that moment, it's boiling hot, and it's right to just say, in Jesus' name. Because now when you say, in Jesus' name, he's behind you on the platform. You're saying it with his presence all over you. And at that moment, Cheryl begins to play a very blessed song. And the minute she plays that song, the presence of God begins to flow. And people just... And I just begin to say, Jesus. And I call on his name. You're glorious. Preparing us your temple. And the people start to weep and cry. We are born as living stones where you're enthroned. And by this time, I'm walking into the Holy of Holies. As you rose from death in power, come rise within our worship. And by that time, you just feel that flow of there. Rise upon our praise. Let the hand, and everybody's getting ready. And by this time, I said, clothe us in your glory. And they start lining up. Because now I've done the job. Jesus is real to them. And the choir starts to sing by me. Oh, the glory of your presence. Why? He's real to them. And I look down and I see tears. We, your temple. And they start to worship and worship. And brother, at that moment, it's like fire. You better lift your hands and bless his name. So arise from your rest and be blessed.
by our praise as we in